Greetings from Emmanuel TV Network. We wish to thank the faithful followers of Emmanuel, God with us, for the show of support by viewing teaser ad and initial programs. We are pleased to inform you that no time is wasted in our efforts to bring you the programs that we will introduce shortly, as we invoke the guidance of the Most Holy Spirit to bring to your family special programs for the kids, young, adults, millennials, and our loving parents, which will bring the family closer to Emmanuel, who loves us unconditionally. Watch for it.
Hello, I'm Tony Palmer. I am the Abbot Bishop of the Order of the Ark Community. Today we are here to introduce to you a video, a very special video. But before I do, I just want to apologize that from time to time I'll be referring to my notes that I have here with me. Because what I want to say, I want to say what we have planned to say, and I don't want to get sidetracked. So please forgive me for referring to notes from time to time. The Ark Community, we are an ecumenical or an interdenominational community of Christians, connected to our common desire to see the manifestation of the visible unity of Christians all over the world. Right now, in our generation, we are witnessing something Jesus prayed for, that God the Father, by His Spirit, is bringing into manifestation right now. And that is the unity of Christians. I see this happening all over the world while I'm on my travels in various denominations. People are desiring for the first time in many generations to be one, to stand together so that the world may believe that the Father sent the Son. We are witnessing the unity of Christians by the Spirit of God and not by the doctrines and traditions of men. This is a spiritual movement. I often tell people that the leader, the founder of the ecumenical movement is Jesus himself in John 17 when he prayed that we would all be one so that the world would believe. This movement has now grown to be over 200 million born-again and Spirit-filled Catholic Christians throughout the world. This is what the movement, how wide the movement is today. It was during one of my missions with the Catholic Church to South America where I met the Archbishop of Buenos Aires, Father Mario Bergoglio. He immediately struck up a relationship with me after hearing my testimony, and eventually he became one of my mentors and later one of my spiritual fathers. Last year, my spiritual father, Father Mario Bergoglio, became Pope Francis. And much to my surprise, our friendship actually continued. I have served under three popes:
Pope John Paul II, Pope Benedict XVI, and now Pope Francis. It is significant to note that Pope Francis is the first pope ever to take the name of the charismatic monk Saint Francis of Assisi,
whose calling was to rebuild the church. And that's exactly what Pope Francis has in his heart to do in his time as pope. It's a real blessing. Pope Francis and I have made covenant to work together for the visible unity of Christians. He asked me and consecrated me to be a bridge for the promotion of Christian unity. We emphasize the word visible, invisible unity, because it's already a theological fact that we are one in Christ. No denominational doctrine, nor any church expression, can destroy this theological fact that we are one in Christ. There is nothing higher than the torn body of Christ on the cross, and that's what makes us one. Not our doctrines, not our traditions. The body of Christ, torn, separated, that we may be made one. In my last meeting with Pope Francis, We made a short video on my iPhone. He wanted to greet all the non-Roman Catholic brothers and sisters and call us all to put an end to the separation between Catholic Christians and all other Christians. We know that the first 1,000 years there was one church, it was called the Catholic Church. And the word Catholic means universal, it doesn't mean Roman. Catholic means, if you're born again, raise your hand if you're born again. You're a Catholic. Take back, redeem what belongs to you. We are Catholics. And then there was the split at the end of the first millennium. We had the Orthodox, the East and West, two churches. Then 500 years later, we have Luther and his protest. Three churches in 1,500 years. Three denominations, not three churches. And then, from Luther's protest onwards, 33,000 new denominations. I've come to understand that diversity is divine. It's division that's diabolic. It's true what you were saying about the glory. I agree with you, of course it's true. The glory that the Father had, he gave to Jesus. The glory was the presence of God. What is the charismatic renewal? It's when we experience the presence of God. And he said, and I give them the glory, pragmatic reason, so that they may be one. It's the glory that glues us together, not the doctrines. It's the glory. If you accept that Christ is living in me and the presence of God is in me and the presence of God is in you, that's all we need. Because God will sort out all our doctrines when we get upstairs. Therefore, Christian unity is the basis of our credibility. Because Jesus said, until they're one, they will not believe. The world will not believe, as they should, until we are one. Division destroys our credibility. It is fear that keeps us separated, because fear is false evidence appearing real. It's an acronym, F-E-A-R, false evidence appearing real, because most of your fear is based on propaganda. Now, why is it historic? Because in 1999, the Roman Catholic Church and the Protestant Lutheran Church signed an agreement that brought an end to the protest. Luther believed that we were saved by grace through faith alone. Amen. But that's not it. The Catholic Church believed that we were saved by works. And that was the protest. In 1999, they wrote this together. Because in the Protestant Church, we had a lot of cheap salvations. People were getting born again, but no fruit whatsoever. And because we didn't even look for fruit, it wasn't the issue, because it wasn't necessary for salvation. And no, it's not. But it's a good judge if you are saved. So what these two churches did, they put the two definitions together. Listen to it. I'm reading verbatim from the Catholic Vatican website. Justification means that Christ himself is our righteousness, in which we share through the Holy Spirit in accord with the will of the Father. Together we, Catholics and Protestants, Lutherans, believe and confess that by grace alone, in faith in Christ's saving works, and not because of any merit on our part, we are accepted by God and receive the Holy Spirit, who renews our hearts while equipping and calling us to good works. Maybe we're all Catholics again. But we are reformed. We're Catholic in the universal sense. We are not protesting the doctrine of salvation by the Catholic Church anymore. We now preach the same gospel. We now preach you are saved by grace through faith alone. The word alone was the argument for 500 years. The word alone is there. You can read it yourself. The protest is over. The protest is over.
dear brothers and sisters. Excuse me, because I speak in Italian, but I cannot speak in English. But I will speak no Italian, no English, but carefully. È una lingua più semplice e più autentica. E questa lingua del cuore ha un linguaggio e una grammatica speciale. La grammatica semplice, due regole. Ama Dio soprattutto e ama l'altro perché è tuo fratello e la tua sorella. E con queste due cose andiamo avanti. Io sono qui con mio fratello, il vescovo fratello Tony Panner. Siamo amici da anni. E lui mi ha detto del vostro convegno, del vostro raduno. E con piacere vi invio un saluto. Un saluto gioioso e nostalgico. Gioioso perché a me dà gioia che voi siete riuniti per lodare Gesù Cristo, l'unico Signore, e per pregare al Padre e ricevere lo Spirito. E questo dà gioia perché si vede che il Signore lavora in tutto il mondo. È nostalgico perché, ma succede come nei quartieri fra noi, no? Nei quartieri ci sono famiglie che si vogliono e famiglie che non si vogliono, famiglie che si uniscono e famiglie che si separano. E noi siamo un po', mi permetto la parola, separati. Separati perché i peccati ci hanno separati, i nostri peccati. I malintesi nella storia, ma una lunga strada di peccato comunitario. Ma chi ha la colpa? Tutti abbiamo la colpa. Tutti siamo peccatori. Soltanto uno è giusto, il Signore. E io ho la nostalgia che questa separazione finisca e ci dia la comunione, la nostalgia di quell'abbraccio di qua, nel quale parla la Sacra Scrittura, quando i fratelli di Giuseppe, affamati, sono andati a Egitto per comprare, per poter mangiare. Ma andavano a comprare, avevano i soldi, ma non potevano mangiare i soldi. E lì hanno trovato qualcosa più del pasto. Hanno trovato il fratello. Tutti noi abbiamo dei soldi, i soldi della cultura, i soldi della nostra storia, di tante ricchezze culturali, anche religiose, tradizioni diverse. Ma dobbiamo trovarci come fratelli e dobbiamo piangere insieme, come ha fatto Giuseppe, quel pianto che unisce. Pianto dell'amore. Io vi parlo come fratello. E vi parlo farlo così, semplicemente, un giorno di nostalgia. Facciamo crescere la nostalgia, perché questo ci spingerà a trovarci, abbracciarci e a lodare Gesù Cristo come unico Signore della storia. Vi ringrazio tanto per sentirmi. Vi ringrazio tanto per lasciarmi parlare la lingua del cuore. E vi chiedo anche un favore, di pregare per me, perché ho bisogno delle vostre preghiere. Io prego per voi, lo farò, ma io ho bisogno delle vostre preghiere e pregare al Signore perché ci unisca tutti. E avanti, siamo fratelli, ci diamo spiritualmente questo abbraccio e lasciamo che il Signore finisca l'opera che Lui ha incominciato. Perché questo è un miracolo, il miracolo dell'unità è incominciato. E dice uno scrittore italiano, il Manzoni, famoso, dice questa frase, in un romanzo, un uomo semplice del popolo dice questa frase: non ho trovato mai che il Signore abbia incominciato un miracolo senza finirlo bene. Lui finirà bene questo miracolo dell'unità. Vi chiedo di benedirmi e io vi benedico. Di fratello a fratello, un abbraccio. Grazie.